Time for another classic end of the year video, and it's very windy tonight, so if you hear that, I apologize, but it's time to talk about my disappointments and my least favorite reads. Luckily, this year really didn't have anything that was too awful. I didn't even really DNF anything this year, so largely was reading things that I really enjoyed, 3.5 star and above. This is basically my 2.5 and 3 star reads, and I guess, disclaimer, these are opinions. You will probably have different experiences with these books. This is not a personal attack on your taste. This is just stuff that didn't work for me, and if you have similar taste to me, maybe pass it by. Or if you have the exact opposite taste of me, go read it. So we're gonna start from like the least egregious, like the least disappointing, and work our way up to things that like I don't like a lot, like strongly disagree with their existence in the artistic universe. So starting off, this is a real like softball, but in general, Wheel of Time's books 6 and 8 were kind of disappointing to me, specifically 6. 8, I knew was the slog. I didn't expect grand things from The Path of Daggers, but Lord of Chaos was supposed to be this like ending of this arc that everyone says is one of their favorites. Like everyone's always like books 4, 5, and 6 are like really solid Robert Jordan entries in Wheel of Time. And I think the only one I kind of liked was Fires of Heaven, and I didn't really like 4, but I read that last year, and it was on last year's disappointments list. And I liked 5, and I really liked 7, but 6 was like really bloated, like extremely long. I do not know why people like 6 more than 7, because 6 has some, I don't know, climactic moments, but it doesn't finish up any arcs. Whereas, like, book 7 actually finishes up arcs. It does amazing character things, so I was disappointed in 6, but I guess having a low bar for 7 was a good thing, and then 8 met my expectations in being a relatively mediocre read. So, pretty softball. I don't think anyone's surprised that this is here. We're probably all still wondering why I'm reading this series, and honestly, it's just to know at this point. It doesn't take too many hours of my time. I was talking to my friend. It's like, if I didn't consistently read 100 or 120 books a year, I wouldn't be reading this series. Like, if I only read 40 books a year and I liked them how I like them, no, they'd be DNF'd. But since they're audiobooks and stuff, I keep going. So this next one, though, was probably surprising because I don't think I really talk about it a lot, mainly because it was disappointing for me. So I love Machineries of Empire by Yoon Ha Lee, and I am extremely confused about Phoenix Extravagant. So I read this earlier this year as a buddy read book club for my Patreon, expecting to love it. It's a standalone fantasy, very kind of steampunk maybe fantasy. I don't know. It's alternate history with different technology in Korean inspired fantasy. And I like a lot of stuff about it, but that ending, that ending is so weird. If you've read it, you know. It's not that book that I wouldn't recommend to people. It's just because I love Machineries of Empire so much, I was just really disappointed that this was, I don't know, it's not even that it was different. It was definitely still Yoon Ha Lee's imaginative brain. It was definitely characters I was used to, although it's a little different from the characters we have seen in Machineries of Empire. But I love Jebby. I love the dragon. I thought it had interesting commentary. But the ending is just so tonally distant from everything else I read. I was so confused. So that's probably why it's here. So those are, I think, my two, like, softballs. Like, we're still largely, like, 3.25, 3.5 reads, but I was bummed by them. And now we are in one that I am so annoyed that I don't like, and that is City of Lies. I wanted to like this. So many of the people that I trust like this really underrated fantasy, and I was really hoping to, and it just didn't work for me. It didn't click, which I don't know why. I mean, there's a couple things that are against it for my like fantasy trope candy. Part of it is it's very low magic. I like to have a lot more magic in my fantasy, and if it doesn't have a lot of magic, I better be connecting to characters left and right, and I wasn't connecting to our two main point of views, although I really love the representation in those point of views, so that was really annoying. And it was a bit long, and a lot of the reveals I didn't find very surprising or interesting. I was like, ah, of course, you are the person who are doing the thing. Aha! Like, so it wasn't a very enjoyable experience for me, and I found myself dragging through it, and that's just never fun. So I was bummed about that, so I'm not going to continue on with it, but this is truly a disappointment. I think it's a fantasy that probably works for a lot of people, and I just really wanted it to work for me. Next up is the fourth book, Imalazin, Book of the Fallen, House of Chains. I have a lot of bad luck with fourth books in series, like fourth book of Wheel of Time, fourth book in Dresden Files. Well, here's the fourth book in Imalazin. I don't know why there's this trend, but for me, I actively had such a hard time reading this book, and I'm really excited for the fifth book. I'm actually already started it, really enjoying it, and I loved the in-depth discussion that happened on Jimmy's channel, and that actually really made me appreciate this book more. But hindsight's 2020. While reading this book, I did not like it. Like, I did not like reading this book. I felt like there were so many things that'll be improved upon when I reread this one day, because I'll have some context. I'll have, like, a frame to put some of this random knowledge into, because when it wasn't just random knowledge being thrown at me, it was the same theme over and over and over again, which can be a choice, but I was so annoyed at the repetition in one area while I was being so drastically confused in another. And although there was a pivotal moment at the end that I did connect with, I'm used to a better payoff at the end of a Imalazin book than I got in this one. So this was disappointing. I didn't hate it. I think I still gave it 3.5 stars. It's just because I really loved the first three so much, I was really hoping to like this one, especially since it's kind of the sequel to Dead House Gates, and I love a lot of the stuff there. And when it did have the marine banters, it was so great, but it didn't do that enough. Like, there was just not enough character interactions for my taste in the way that I like them to be done in a Imalazin book. But like I said, already really enjoying Midnight Tides. This was a disappointment just because I have been really loving this series, and this one was so much work for me. All right, up next is The Shadow King. This is a historical fiction that had won a lot of awards or been nominated for a lot of awards, and I really liked the premise of looking at the 1930s in Ethiopia when Mussolini's invading and how they fought back and getting it through the lens of the women warriors whose stories weren't told. I was so down for that. And again, it was just one of those things that dragged. I was never engaged. I was never invested. I couldn't like any characters, and any character I liked, I was always sad for. And I understand this is a really dark topic and that you're trying to shed light on, but it was just so hard, and especially for how long it is. This is a pretty long historical fiction, like 400 some pages. And I liked the narrative framing. I liked the different narrative voices the author chose to use. I liked the content. The execution was just a miss for me, and I was bummed because this is such a unique, like, lens of historical fiction, you know? Like, we're so used to World War II historical fiction, and yes, this is World War II adjacent, but it's before World War II, and it's in a part of the front of the war that we never talk about. We never talk about what happens in Africa or the Middle East when it comes to World War II, at least I don't see that a lot in my textbooks or in the historical fictions that I read. So I was really excited, and I mean, Robin Miles got me through it, but it was a rough time. And similarly, I don't think I had high expectations for this one, but Lonesome Dove was one of the first historical fictions I read this year, and I was just bummed that I didn't love this because I know it's Ryan's, one of his favorite books. It's one of the books that got him back into reading, and I really wanted to like it, and I did really like the first part. And then once we switched into the second part, I got really annoyed because I didn't like what they chose to do, which is add in more characters. And then once we got to the third part, I was like, I'm annoyed with why you added those characters. Like, there were decisions that were made and it was too long. Like, if that book had been 500 pages instead of 800, I probably would have had a better time. Like, I didn't like how I felt that I was trying to be emotionally manipulated by the author, and I didn't think it really worked for me. So yeah, and it dragged. So I was bummed just because Ryan loves it so much, and I can see why. And I can see why it's so many people's favorite. But Westerns aren't always my thing anyways, and then I didn't like the choice of halfway through the book adding new characters. I'm like, I'm attached to these guys. Show me these guys. And I didn't think there was payoff for meeting new people. I actually thought it lessened my experience with the book. All right, we're now getting into the range of I went from disappointed to downright annoyed because these books took my time and I almost want my time back. Like, we're in this gray space, right? We're not quite at I really didn't like these books, but we are moving out of disappointment range. And we're going to start that off with what do I have written down? Deacon King Kong, which is a book that annoys me because it's so good, except for the ending. And this is very subjective. I actually know many people who love the ending of this book, and I am not one of them. I love how this story is written. I love looking at a community in New York City. I think it's the 1960s. Specifically, it's a Black community, I think in Brooklyn. I can't remember. I don't think it's the Bronx. I think it's Brooklyn. Regardless, I probably have the neighborhood wrong, but I loved how the community was written. I'm a sucker for literary fiction that looks at communities. And I really liked the humor and the literary writing style. Like, there's a section where you just, like, follow an ant. And it's so humorous, and the characters are so vibrant, except I hated the main character. I hated Deacon King Kong. I hated what he was representing. I didn't like how we were meant to be sympathetic for this man, even regardless of his past and what we learn about him. I didn't want to sympathize with him. I actively didn't like that he was the focal point of this story, but I was okay with it. I was moving along with it, but then the ending happens, and I really, really didn't like the ending, and I can't talk about it without spoiling things, but people in my Discord know what I'm talking about, because I talked about it, like, with spoiler bars and stuff, but it's one of my least favorite things. Like, and I talked about it at book club, being like, how do you guys think this is romantic? How do you guys think this is a good ending? I think this is bad. I think thematically, I disagree with what is being portrayed here. I'm not saying the author believes this or whatever, but whatever happened at the end of the book, I did not agree with. And I do think, based off how many people responded to it and how it was written, it was meant to be this great thing. And I thought it was bad. I did not like it. So I was bummed, because up until the ending, besides, like, our main pivotal character and what he represents, I loved the writing of this book. I will read more by this author, because I'm not, like, thrown off by them. I just, like, oh, this book could have been, there's literally, like, one plot decision, and it's a favorite book of the year, almost. Like, that's how good the writing is, but really, really don't like that ending. We're going to talk about Lagoon next, which maybe should have been earlier on the list, because now that I'm thinking about it, I don't actually feel like I'm as annoyed at it. But at the time, I was really like, is this over yet? Which I feel bad. This was kind of in my phase of learning that action sci-fi might not work for me as much as I think it does. I am unsure. But this is a First Contact story written by Nnedi Okorafor, set in Nigeria. I think in response to a First Contact story movie that I haven't seen. I don't remember the name of the movie. Maybe editing Angela's put it on the screen. Regardless, the premise is really interesting, and I was excited about it. I love First Contact stories, and I generally like the imagination of Nnedi Okorafor. But this was just not good for me. I couldn't form any character connections. Everything was too fast. It was too fast. There were so many characters. Stuff happens off page, and then you see them again, and you're just like, what's happening? And it's so fast, and yet also so long. I don't understand. So I was bummed. So I have read many Nnedi Okorafors, and I always want to like her works so much. Like, the only one I really like is Remote Control. Largely, I was disappointed by the Binti trilogy, and this is also disappointing to me. But I'm still going to try Noor, and I'm probably still going to try the Akata Witch trilogy, because I love her ideas. And I do think there were interesting things in Lagoon, but it just didn't work for me, and I was just like, wanted it to be over, and it would not end. And I think it was purely like I was not connected to any of the characters, because I wasn't allowed to. Things happened too quickly. I couldn't form connections with them, and they weren't forming connections with each other. Or suddenly, like, this is one of the few moments where I was like, is this insta love, like, or did this happen off page and I just didn't get to see it? Because I know something happened off page. But so yeah, I was a little annoyed, but mostly disappointed. So this probably should have been earlier, but alas. All right, up next is Conflict Is Not Abuse, which was the first book for Jess Owen's nonfiction book club, and we discussed it. And I think for me, this was more of a situation of, I agree with what you're saying, but I don't think you believe what you're saying. Like, it was really odd. It was one of those works that was asking for a lot of nuance, but then in their examples, there was no nuance. It was really odd. We have a whole discussion where we all talk about how, like, in theory, we agree with some of the things she's saying and how these are useful frameworks, but also there is even more nuance than what she is putting into this. Like, it was really weird. And some of the examples that she shows to use from her own life, I'm just like, you read this and your editor read this and no one thought that this was a, like, a good example. Like, everyone thought this was good, and I was just like, okay, whatever. So, I mean, luckily I did the audiobook and I wasn't, like, too annoyed. It just, like, wasn't great for me. Like, I think this is further up just because objectively I did give it, like, a 2.5 stars. Like, it didn't make me upset, and I was just more, like, rolling my eyes at her most of the time, and it led to a good discussion. But, like, I didn't like how it was executed. I think in some ways she could have alienated people with the points she was making with her ridiculous stories, so, yeah. Alright, and this is, like, the last one before books that just make me rage, and this is The Stars Are Legion by Cameron Hurley. I love The Light Brigade. I really do. The Stars Are Legion is way more boring than it deserves to be for how cool of a concept it is on paper. Your main character has amnesia. Does know where they are, and they're on this, like, squish goo planet, and there's, like, invasion of another planet, and they have to go through all of the levels of the planet to figure things out and save the day, and it's a really cool world building, and it's a really interesting premise, and gosh, did I not care. I think I had a huge buddy read for this with a bunch of my friends. We were all doing this casually. I might have been one of two people who finished it. I know a bunch of people DNF'd it, because it was so boring. Like, oh my goodness, it would never end. It was not even that long, and it should have been cool. Like, there was so much intrigue potential. The world is so cool, and then you don't even really get answers. It's like, I do not know what's happening in this book. Like, I have no clue. I just, so it was very disappointing, and I was also a bit annoyed because I hate being bored. I really despise it. I just do not like when I am bored at all. Like, I know that there are way worse crimes in the world, but I don't know. And maybe I should have DNF'd it, but I kept thinking, like, I want to know the reveal because there's so much we didn't know. So I was like, maybe things would be reframed, because especially when it's, like, you know, kind of a sci-fi thriller mystery thing like this was. And yeah, no, that didn't happen. So that was probably a book I should have DNF'd. Yeah, and we're getting into the range of books that I for sure should have DNF'd, so. Starting with Shuggy Bane, because this isn't Shuggy Bane's fault, it's my fault. I should have DNF'd this book. But I was reading it for a local book club, and no one was forcing me to read it. I wasn't moderating or anything. I could have DNF'd at any point, but I am stubborn, and I kept reading it. So this is a story about, it's the 1980s in Glasgow, Scotland, I believe, and it's a family with a mom and a son and an estranged husband, and the mom has an alcohol problem. She's an alcoholic. And you follow Shuggy's life from a small kid to a young adult, essentially, and what he has to deal with as a child of an alcoholic parent, but also as a coming-out gay kid in Glasgow, Scotland, which is also very impoverished. Basically, nothing good happens to Shuggy. And my issues with this book, before it actually came to my personal issues, is that every chapter really requires its own list of trigger warnings, because that is how much trauma these characters have to go through on page. Do I believe people go through this much trauma in real life? Yes, of course. I have gone through many things that Shuggy's gone through in this book, and that's part of my personal issues. But I would have preferred an execution where some happiness was used and not used to emotionally manipulate me. The only happy moments are meant to be there so you can be smushed into the dirt. Which is a choice. And, like, I'm not here to tell the author he's not allowed to write this work. I mean, I think it was very cathartic for him. This is very autobiographical for him. I shouldn't have read it. I should have DNF'd it. I hated reading this book. It triggered me. I have never been triggered while reading a book. I literally had a depressive spiral for days reading this as a child who had a parent with a drug problem. Like, it was horrible. It was absolutely horrible. Which, I mean, maybe speaks to the realness of the work. I just didn't need it. I didn't need it, and I should have stopped. So I have issues with the execution separate from my own personal issues, but it gets compounded in my head. So this isn't the book's fault, but I also just feel like there was a choice made to show the most depressing angles for 500 pages. And I don't think I like that choice. I think I like a more gentle approach, maybe. I don't know. Maybe I'm weak. Who knows? Did not like this book, like, at all, and I should have DNF'd it. So that's one that's my bad. I guess technically I could have DNF'd this, but I had made it so far, and I think this is mislabeled. So I have a series review for this in the fall. I have reviews actually for the next three because I was angry. So this is the Witcher series, books 4 and 5, because I read those this year. And I actually liked Baptism of Fire. But goodness gracious, calling a series The Witcher and not putting The Witcher on the page is a lie. That is bad marketing. Well, good marketing in terms of people like me picking it up and keeping hoping Geralt will show up. But no. Let's have an hour-long chapter, because that was the audiobook length, an hour-long on the economics of this kingdom that I can't remember its name, because that's interesting. I'm sure someone found that interesting. I did not. Because that's not the series I picked up. If I had known what the project was before picking it up, I probably A, wouldn't have picked it up, or B, would have been more patient. Like, I am patient with Malaz and Book of the Fallen because I know its project. Here, I was told this is about The Witcher and Ciri and Yennefer. It's not. It really isn't. And it kind of is. And that ending. I don't like the ending. It's not a bad ending, but I don't like it. And I don't like that the ending kind of doesn't make sense if you don't know, like, an Arthurian myth or something. Like, I feel like that's annoying, especially since for the first 4 books, that hasn't mattered. I feel like this isn't a spoiler because the name of the 5th book is The Lady of the Lake. But, like, yeah, there was a lot that, like, I didn't like, probably primarily because the main character is not on page, and I'm a very character-driven reader, and the world is cool, but not cool enough for me to get an economics lesson for an hour. Like, goodness. And it's really dark. Really, really dark, which is fine, like, but, like, it went from being, like, this cool, like, dark fairy tale retelling series to, like, just this grim, dark, everything is awful, look how bad humanity is series. And that's fine. But I didn't love that. So, I don't know. But, plus side, I'm really liking Witcher Season 2. That's been great. So I still like The Witcher. Geralt is still fantastic. I just don't... I don't know what the 5 novel series should be called, but it shouldn't be called The Witcher. That's my opinion. Up next is The Burning God and the Poppy War series, right? Yep, that's my second to last one. So I have a should you read for this, like I said. I should have DNF'd this book. I finished part 2, I think, and I got really pissed because of reasons. I just, narratively, I was like, what's the point? Why did I just read hundreds of pages? Like, why? But I was like, I should keep reading, see what happens to this character I've been following for books. I already predicted what would happen, and it's what happened, and I got no catharsis. I was just like, oh, I could have just read this on a Wikipedia page, and I would feel exactly the same as I do now, except I spent 4 hours reading what would have taken me 20 minutes on a Wikipedia page. I was really annoyed, and I like the Poppy War. Like, I gave both the Poppy War and the Dragon Republic 4 stars. It's not like I didn't like this series. This isn't like me with the Wheel of Time, where maybe I should stop reading it. This was a series I legitimately liked the writing style of, and I liked the characters, and I liked the premise, but boy, the plot direction was not it, and I think that she should have had more point of views from a character that we did get point of views from in the Dragon Republic, and just suddenly don't, really, in The Burning God. Like, I would have taken out a lot of part 2 and put those point of views in. I was so mad. I hate when endings are bad. I really do. I'm a big endings person, and I don't hate what happened. I hate the execution, okay? Like, I know some people were like, but I really liked what happened at the end. It's like, I don't dislike what happened to our main characters at the end of the book. I think that made sense. But, like, I actually like what happens in season 8 of Game of Thrones, but I can agree that, yeah, we didn't spend the proper time getting there, okay? Like, that's what I mean in terms of how I feel. But taking my top slot of rage disappointment is Dark Matter, which technically I think I rated it higher than The Burning God, but that's largely because it's a short book, and it took me like 2 days to read, so I didn't have to spend a lot of time being full of rage. Whereas Burning God, I spent like 7 days. Ugh, still annoyed. But Dark Matter does a lot of things I don't like. And I have a full video with Ryan where we discuss in detail what I don't like. And I won't talk about anything that could spoil Dark Matter here. I'm not going to do that. It's a thriller. I'm not going to get into that. But Jason. Jason is supposed to be this intelligent man. He's a professor. He knows physics. I'm a physics person. I'm about to get a PhD. This guy is so dumb, and he's the most harmful trope to me. I hate the smart guy but doesn't have street sense. Like, intelligence is not binary. There is a spectrum. And I also just, like, I just didn't like being in his head, and it's first person point of view, and we were just with Jason the whole time, and he was just such a dummy. He was so dumb, like, the whole time. And, like, it's one of those stories. The back of the book says one day he wakes up and he's no longer has a world where his family is. Okay, that's the premise. This whole time he's trying to get back to his family. He doesn't think about his kid once. It's always about his really sexy hot wife, which, like, fair. But you have a kid. It's like your biological kid. Think about him for, like, a second. So, yeah. So, not only did I dislike strongly Jason and the trope that he is, because he doesn't feel like a character to me. He feels like any main protagonist in a Christopher Nolan film ever. Like, he is very much cookie-cutter dude. Like, I didn't feel like he was a unique individual. He was just the trope of the scientist character who, like, doesn't have a good work-life balance or whatever. I didn't like Jason. But then add on to it the themes of you can only be successful or you can only have a family. Didn't like that. And then add on to it this book's trying to be hard sci-fi, which I am not a sci-fi snob. I say over and over again, I don't care if science fiction leads into the fiction. I don't care as long as it's in-world consistent. I don't think the sci-fi element is sci-fi. I think it's magic. I think of it as magical realism, and I feel way better because it is not consistent within its own parameters. And you can fight me. I know what they were trying to do, and it he says he talked to scientists, but, like, I have a very basic understanding of physics, and I know that what we were doing here does not pass the sniff test. Like, I don't know what was happening. But regardless, I was just bored, too. I was really bored. And then it was really funny when Ryan was reading it, because he would get to certain parts and come home, and he would just be like, oh my god, this thing just happened. Like, what? Like, this would be a great movie. It'd be a fantastic Christopher Nolan movie. But in terms of a book, I was annoyed. And I liked Recursion. And I don't think it's the case of if you like Recursion, you won't like Dark Matter or vice versa, because that does happen. I think Recursion I liked because it had two point of views. And one of them is basically the Jason in this book, although he isn't a physicist in the other one. And the scientist character in the other book is a woman. And so I liked having two people, I think, versus just being with Jason. Oh my god. I do think if I had cared at all about Jason, this would have been a fun experience and I could have just enjoyed the ride. Because I can see it being a book that you can just enjoy the ride. I don't think it's a bad book. It just had a lot of stuff that annoys me, okay? And these are the type of videos where people just want you to share your feelings. So that's just what I'm doing here, okay? Again, though, your taste is not bad if you love Dark Matter or any of the other books that I've trashed in this video, because art is subjective. I feel like I shouldn't have to say that, but the internet is a scary place, guys. Okay, so if you don't have anything nice to say, I'm deleting your comments. But otherwise, feel free to chat about things. Don't put any spoilers for books. I have to delete those comments if you spoil a book because I do not want people to get spoiled in the comments of my videos. So yeah, say nice things, only nice things. We can have really fun debate. That's allowed. Debate's always fun. But also don't call me dumb or whatever. Like, you'd be so shocked at what people put in the comment sections of my friends' videos. I'm so lucky that my comment sections are usually great, but, like, every time I decide to have, like, unpopular opinions, I just feel like I need to tell you that I don't care. Like, I'm just gonna delete them and move on with my day, because, like, you could be spending minutes of your life watching people love things you love, and you chose to come here to a video that is full of hate, so, yeah. That's on you. But yeah, that's this video. Let me know what your disappointments were of the year. Anything you really didn't like. Even if it's one of my favorites, you have my permission in the comments of this video to trash my faves. But be polite, maybe not. I don't know. Your call. And if you want to leave an emoji, I don't know, leave like an X or a frowny face or something. Like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.